to the championship distance for the first time. Four fights, four wins. She's been brought through nicely by Rossana Mates over her left shoulder, Brian Peters over her right shoulder, promoter Eddie Hearn as well. Six rounds, eight rounds, they've been negotiated. Now up to 10 rounds. I don't think there's any doubt that she's got the stamina, the gas in the tank to cope with that. And this for the WBA Intercontinental title at lightweight. Effectively, we understand, will be an eliminator for a world title. And there's the view from up high over Wembley Stadium. I cannot overemphasize just how spectacular this is. I wasn't here for Frotchgrove's Darren. I was in Germany actually covering Felix Sturm, Sam Solomon. It was a good fight, but it wasn't like this.
No, I mean, this really is special. I wasn't at Frotchgrove's too either. I was out of the country, but it's just, I mean, I'm so proud to be here. It's amazing. And Katie Taylor there looking extremely focused. I mean, there's some real talent out there in the women's game at the minute, but I really do think Katie Taylor could be the next big thing.
It's another big, big stage. It's been on big undercards already, but there is none bigger than this.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Eddie Hearn's Matchroom Boxing. The Klitschko Management Group and K2 Promotions very proud to bring us 10 two-minute rounds for the WBA International Lightweight Crown. Proudly sponsored by McFit, by William Hill, by StubHub and by JD Sports. Sanctioned by the World Boxing Association, President Gilberto Mendoza, our supervisor, Aurelio Fiango, and the British Boxing Board of Control, Chairman John Rees QC, our steward in charge, Mr. Mick Collier. At ringside, our three judges scoring. From Leeds, England, Dave Paris. From Puerto Rico, Nelson Vasquez. From New Jersey, USA, Steve Weisfeld. On the bell, our timekeeper, Brett Bowles. And when the bell rings, referee in charge, from Doncaster, England, Mr. Howard Foster. And now, ladies and gentlemen, time to meet the boxers. In the red corner, wearing black shorts with silver trim. At the weigh-in, she's scaled 9 stone, 6 pounds, 8 ounces. Has a perfect professional record. 5 contests, 5 wins, 2 wins inside the distance. Reigning WBC Youth Super Featherweight Champion, from Spandau, Berlin, Germany, Nina the Brave Minka. In the blue corner, wearing black shorts with gold. Official weight, 9 stone, 8 pounds, 9 ounces. 5 times a world amateur champion, Olympic Games gold medalist, undefeated as a professional. 4 contests, 4 wins, 2 wins inside the distance. Tonight she challenges for her first professional title, from Bray County Wicklow, the fighting pride of all Ireland, Katie Taylor.
Kerr spoke to you both in the dressing room. You both, I expect, keep it clean, break straight away when told. Both watch your heads in close. Good luck to you both. Touch gloves. Good luck.
Well, we know plenty about Katie Taylor, of course, less so about Nina Menka, but her opponent tonight has got an interesting story. She was at the World Championships in 2014 in Korea, as was Taylor. Taylor won gold there. Menka, an experienced international amateur, has spent a lot of time in the UK. Came here as an exchange student at 14, was already boxing at that stage. Her dad is very good friends with Sven Otka, who trains her. Otka, the former WBA and IBF super middleweight champion, who retired undefeated. She spent a couple of years in Scarborough boxing at Westway BC when she was doing her A-levels over here, Menka, and as recently as last summer was working at a scrapyard in Tamworth, selling catalytic converters. She's an engaging character. Had a good chat with her the other day, and she can fight as well. Five fights, 5 wins so far. She admits that she's always admired Katie Taylor, but she's not just come here to make up the numbers tonight, that's for sure.
Very lively start by both girls here. Fast pace. One thing with Menko, I noticed that at the media workout, though she seems very relaxed, really taking in the atmosphere and the occasion. When she got to work, I was very impressed with how sharp she was. And I spoke to her afterwards, and she was saying, you know, though she's lapping it all up, she really wants to win here and make a statement in the women's game.
Menko boxing out of that southpaw stance. Taylor has overwhelmed opponents at times during her career, thrown bundles of punches forward at a very, very high pace. She's made a nice, considered start here. Taylor's last opponent, Milena Kaleva, is actually a sparring partner of Menko, and it was after that fight that Menko's father got the idea that they could get this fight with Taylor. They pursued it, Menko's team, and eventually they got their hands on it. A couple of weeks ago, they got the call. She was given 20 minutes to decide. It wasn't a difficult decision. And she feels that if she can box well tonight, whatever the outcome, then that will be a step forward for her. A no-lose situation, if you like, as we hit the end of round one. Any second now, that ring canopy will come into view. There it is, just right in the centre of this Wembley pitch. I've been here countless times for football, but it's just so different when that focus is on that squared circle. There's some good action in that first round, Darren.
Yeah, good start by Katie second Taylor there. I mean, this could be a difficult night for Menko. She's moving very quickly around the ring. It could be a tough night for her, I think.
Taylor's been over in Connecticut. It's a well-established routine for her now, training over there with Ross Enemate. She hasn't spent too much time away from there, really, over the last few months. Made her debut just a few hundred yards away at Wembley Arena back at the end of November. Manchester before Christmas, at the O2 at the start of March, and here again.
Mixes it up so well, Katie Taylor. Love the way, you know, straight shot, hooks to the body, hooks to the head, straight to the head. I mean, the variety is fantastic. And I said it before on the ring walk. I mean, though there are, you know, huge talent out there in the women's game, I truly do believe Katie Taylor could be the next big thing.
Just caught Menko with a left hand there. Well, there have been a lot of high-profile names turning over. Really, it's the first crop of Olympians coming through. We've had two Olympic Games now with women's boxing, but it's after Rio 2016 that we've seen the likes of Taylor, Adams, Shields, Marlon Esparza as well, to throw another one in, who turned professional, and it has brought a big spotlight onto women's boxing. With greater attention, though, does come greater scrutiny, and I think people who have started to look at women's boxing who didn't previously are realising now what the standard is. Left to the body there from Menko was a good shot.
Well, like it's in the women's game, is the willingness to all get in there with each other. You know, they go up and down in weight. And I was speaking to Brian Peters, Taylor's manager, and he's looking to move her on quite quickly.
Menko looking to try and set up that backhand. She's been a little bit more aggressive in this second round. Luke Campbell in action later on against Arlys Perez, one of four Olympic gold medalists on the bill tonight. He looks nice and relaxed as he just makes his way into the bowels of Wembley Stadium, which is a pretty huge place, as I'm sure you're getting the gist of that from those overhead shots. It's like watching ants just running around on a carpet at ringside. And the gum shield, I don't think, has gone in at the start of the round there for Menko. She'll certainly need that.
A lot reddening to the face, Menko, already. Kate Taylor really stalking her, making her work very hard on her feet this early in the fight. It's been a superb start from Taylor. Menko's got to try and hurt Katie Taylor, make her think about what's coming back, because at the minute she's having it all her own way.
That's what we've seen in her fights up until this point. Nobody's really been able to stop her in her tracks, and and just demand that much kind of respect off her, really.
It's just, it's the accuracy and the power that she carries. I mean, it's quite frightening, really. Though it's sort of one-punch KO sort of power, she does demand respect. And you can see it here, to get Banker to be moving this quickly, this early, just shows that she does carry power.
Just falling in a little bit behind that backhand there, Menke. That could be a costly mistake to make, but Taylor was just a little bit too far away to be able to capitalise. She's moving those shoulders, Taylor, as she comes in.
You can see there as well the pedigree that Taylor has. When she did fall short there, she countered with a quick left hook. Just showed the class of fighter she is.
Menke lands that left hand to the body every now and again, but it's not putting any kind of a dent in Taylor, who, as soon as she gets into range, just throws those lefts and rights in such rapid succession that there's no real opportunity for her opponent to do anything other, really, than try and cover up or move away. Menke just trying to fake with that front foot a bit, see if she can draw something from Katie Taylor, who's not having any of that. Olympic way filling up, people making their way down to Wembley Stadium. It's been a busy place this week. We had a terrific turnout for the weigh-in at Wembley Arena, which is just next door. Yesterday, the open workouts on Wednesday as well. The build-up all week has just been bubbling under.
Round four.
It's now on the simmer, and it will be boiling here later on, 10 o'clock, when Vladimir Klitschko, Anthony Joshua get into that ring. Katie Taylor, though, with business to take care of here into the fourth round. WBA lightweight title eliminator, that title held by Cecilia Comunales from Uruguay, 14 wins, one defeat. She won it in June last year. Good point you were making earlier on, Darren, about how women in different weights will kind of gravitate towards each other. Super feather, lightweight, super lightweight. I think she'll struggle to get down to super featherweight from what I'm told by her training team. Well, they'd rather not anyway, but she'd certainly go up to super lightweight. And other fighters will want to come to meet her because she is a fight that people will want.
Yeah, she's a huge draw and boxing on big shows throughout the country. So obviously people are going to want to fight her. I mean, like I said, Brian Peters really, you know, said she's still learning, but we're willing to put her in with almost anyone very soon.
Left eye of Menke isn't looking too clever at times. You mentioned the reddening up of the face, which started to happen pretty much in the first round. She's still looking to try and throw with some ambition here, Menke. The head's almost coming together there as she kind of stumbled forward. But Taylor just stalks you. She's always crowding you with that front foot. There's always some kind of imminent threat there. Menke is wary of it, as you would be.
It's just so good how she goes through the paces. She's never one paced. She doesn't really throw single shots. She puts them together really well. I mean, if there was one criticism or one bit for us to say, is just feint a little bit before. Try and open your opponent up and then let the combinations go. That was a good right hand there by Katie Taylor. Menke felt that.
Nice left hand there too in the closing stages of round four. And I'm not sure if Menke is going to be able to withstand too much more of this by the look of her face. As we hit the bell. Troy Deeney, the Watford player there, in conversation with Tony Sims. Deeney and Anthony Joshua, good friends, of course. Always good to see people in watching the undercard. He'll be nervous, though. He'll be nervous for his friend. There's absolutely no two ways about that. Most people are. Eddie Hearn describing himself earlier on as being petrified, and you can understand why, because we just don't know. Nobody knows what's going to happen later on. Anyone who, after the event, claimed that they did know in the first place is lying. Taylor coming forward, tries to shoot out that jab and catches Menke, who herself was on the way in to throw.
See, Menke, she starts the round with the intention to try and hold the centre of the ring, but Katie Taylor just doesn't let her stay there. Pushes her straight back. She's been sinking in some nice body shots, especially in the last round. She'll be looking for some more in this round. Again, just putting them together so nice and so quick. Her hands are a razor sharp. And there's blood on the left eye of Menke there. Cut has opened up, and it looks like a bad one as well.
Just above that left eye. Was it a punch or did the heads possibly come together? The heads have been close on occasions. But she's just beginning to get busted up here, Menkerow's having a good look at her corner in between rounds to see what they were making of it all, to see how they were looking at her, the kind of signs she was giving them back. But she may be near the end of the road with this, to be honest with you.
Andy, that's a huge cut there. That really is a bad cut. I'm surprised the ref's not had a look at this yet. That's opened up bad.
And the eye's really swelling. You can almost see it swelling. It's coming up second by second. And this is a bruising encounter for Menka so far. Good courage from her, though. She's not really dabbed at it or wiped at it or showed any kind of sign of being too concerned with it at all. But Taylor, again, just keeps throwing these hands left to the body, followed by right to the ribcage as well.
The corner really here, or the referee needs to have a look, because, you know, this is all one-way traffic. She's got a terrible cut. It's not getting any easier. Landed a lovely left hook there.
Now Foster just getting in at the end of the round. Sven Okra, as I mentioned, the trainer, extremely experienced. Manka's boyfriend is in there as well, Surda Sahin. He is a professional fighter himself. And let's just see if we can have a look and find out exactly how this happened. The heads did come together at one point. Just there. There they go. That was a pretty hefty clump, to be honest. And that's where the cut was caused. It's an accidental clash of heads, no doubt about that.
It was just one of them. You can't do anything about it. But from what I can see here, it does look like a nasty cut. And I mean, she really is up against it here. She hasn't won a round and it's looking extremely tough. I mean, I think the corner really do have to think about putting her out here.
Well, Howard Foster just going over to that corner and telling them that it was a clash of heads. We're well past the conclusion of the fourth round, the start of the fifth round. So if this were to be halted due to that cut caused by the clash of heads, then we go to the cards and Katie Taylor would be ahead. It's as simple as that. And it would be mission accomplished. But they're sending her out for another one here, the Menka corner. I'm not sure about the wisdom of that, if I'm perfectly honest, but into round six we go, into the second half of the fight. This WBA lightweight title eliminator, Katie Taylor in the black and gold, Nina Menka in the black shorts.
Perhaps I was mistaken there. Where there was blood on the cut, it looked like it was terrible, but I don't actually think it's that bad. But there is swelling, obviously, where it was a clash of heads. The swelling has come up. But at first, when I see that, I thought it was a terrible cut. And fair play to her. She's trying to have a go here. Showing lots and lots of heart. But again, she really is up against it.
Bit of blood on the side of the nose there of Taylor. I think that's probably come from Menka, as she again just comes forward. Left hand there from Taylor caught Menka. Just doesn't get a moment's peace, just trying to put out that left hand, that backhand to keep Katie Taylor off, but it fell slightly short.
Menka just can't put a dent in Katie Taylor. She just can't stop her coming. I mean, she's exchanged with a few shots. She has caught Katie Taylor, but just can't hurt her at all.
As I mentioned, Cecilia Comunales, the WBA lightweight champion. Delphine Poussoun, a Belgian fighter, 38 wins, 1 defeat, is a WBC champion. She's pretty much recognised as being the number one in this lightweight division. As we've been mentioning, she could travel up to super lightweight. Welterweight would be too far, the team were telling me. I asked them, really, because the biggest name in the game at the minute is Cecilia Breckers, who holds all the belts, all the marbles at 147 pounds, but they would say that would be too far for Taylor, and Breckers is struggling to make that weight anymore herself anyway, so possibly that is a fight that wouldn't happen. But you have to give Menka a lot of credit here, because she has got some skills. She has come to play a full part in this fight, and I think I jumped the gun a bit maybe when I was saying that the end could be nigh for her. She is taking some punishment, but she's still competitive.
Yeah, she's still in the fight. She hasn't won a round. She definitely come in with the intention of winning, but she just up against a far superior boxer in Katie Taylor. She's faster, she hits harder. She just has that pedigree, and it showed. I mean, she's coming back, she finishes every argument. Good hooks, finishing lovely with the left hook. mixing it up to the body there. There's that variety I'm talking about, finishing with the left foot. I mean, it's fantastic stuff, but again, you go back to Menka, I mean, you have to applaud her courage and her heart. She's still in there.
Seconds out, round seven.
Well, Howard Foster's called a timeout here. The corner, the Menka corner, taking too long really to vacate the ring, to be perfectly honest. Round gets underway, round seven. Wembley Stadium is gradually filling up. Luke Campbell we saw arrive earlier on. He's got Darlings Perez. Scott Quigg is back as well. The first time we'll see him since he decamped to the wild card in Los Angeles under Freddie Roach. Taylor just working away on the inside, just flurries of punches to the ribcage and then switched upstairs.
Lovely work to the body there, good flurry of punches to the body, then finishes back with left hook to the head. Really going to work here, such fast hands.
The way she works those hands is very impressive, but would you like to see her at times just maybe just steady yourself a bit, set her feet a bit more and just get a bit more weight on individual shots?
She is guilty of smothering her own work. The referee's waved it off, and I think that's the right thing to do there. I mean, she was really up against it, losing every round, had the cut. And when you've got a woman like Katie Taylor stalking you like that, letting barrage of punches go, head and body, and being that far into the fight, I just think, you know, that was the correct thing to do there.
Well, it's hard to argue. It is hard to argue. And Taylor, with the win, picks up her first professional title, that WBA Intercontinental Lightweight title, and wins that eliminator. So she, in theory, should be facing Cecilia Comunales, who we mentioned earlier on. 14 wins, one defeat. A Uruguayan fighter who won that title in June last year. And they'll be trying to get her into the ring as soon as they can. And Menka backed up what she's been saying to us during the course of the week, that she'd come here to try and give Katie Taylor a test and that she would put everything into this, and she's certainly done that. Put herself in the shop window for other fights. Another interesting thing is Tasha Jonas has turned pro recently. Of course, they met in the London 2012 Olympics, and you're always talking about domestic rivalries. People are always looking for those. She needs a bit of time to get her own career underway, but maybe that could be one for down the line. And just this action from that final round, the corner, it was close to them. I think they were looking at it and decided that enough was enough.
Correct from the referee there. He knew he was closest to them there. He could see that Katie Taylor was miles in front. Menka didn't have a chance, really. She was just up against a far superior opponent. And we talk about titles. That's the first of many for Katie Taylor, that's for sure.
OK, well, let's get to our MC, Craig Stephen.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the official time is 57 seconds of round number seven. Referee Howard Foster stops this contest. His opinion, Nina Menka in a position to continue. The winner, now the WBA International Lightweight Champion, Katie Taylor.
Well, a first pro title for Taylor.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please show your appreciation?
Always a big moment when that belt gets strapped around the waist. A full world title is what she will want before too long, and we're extremely confident that she will get it. Still just five fights into a pro career, which promises so much. We mentioned the likes of Nicola Adams, who's underway now as well, Caressa Shields, Olympic gold medalists all turning professional, and the spotlight now is much more on women's professional boxing really than it has ever been. And with role models like Katie Taylor, you'd imagine that it will stay fairly intense and she'll be able to enjoy the rest of the evening now.
Yeah, she will do. I was just looking at Brian Peters, looked over to us then and said there's still room for improvement. He had a smile on his face, but they're perfectionists and they'll know there's still work to do, but there are some big fights out there for her. And I think that first world title isn't far away at all.
Well, she's very modest, very softly spoken, has achieved so much. I think feels it's now time to put to bed the discussion of world titles and European championships and Olympic gold medals as an amateur, because that was then and this is very much now. And handshake with promoter Eddie Hearn. Katie's down ringside now and ready to speak to Andy Scott.
Katie, Katie, 5 months as a pro, 5 wins as a pro, and arguably one of your most dominant. How highly do you rate that performance tonight?
I'm always a bit critical of myself, really. I thought it was a bit scrappy at times, but she's a very, very good opponent. She was a great amateur pedigree as well, so I was expecting a very tough fight, but just absolutely delighted. These are moments that I dream of, and my first of many titles, please God.
Weight-wise, you were stepping up to lightweight tonight. How do you find that that suited you?
Yeah, the last few fights I boxed at 135 pounds, so this is perfect for me. I feel very strong and very good at this weight, so I hope to unify the division soon.
Yeah, these interviews between you and I are getting a bit like Groundhog Day. I keep asking you how many fights until a world title fight. That was a WBA eliminator. In your own mind, are you a couple of fights away? Are you more than that? Are you less than that? What do you think?
Yeah, definitely like to get a couple of more 10-rounders under my belt for sure, but I feel like I'm ready right now to box for a world title, but we'll leave that to the likes of Eddie, and I'm just going to continue to do my job and step into the ring and perform. But just want to thank Eddie and Sky for this incredible opportunity, and thank God for a great victory tonight. Thank God for the people that he's put around me, and this is just incredible. This is a dream come true.
You boxed on the biggest stage as an amateur, obviously, in the Olympic final winning gold. How does this compare to boxing in front of a stadium full of people?
I was thinking before that earlier on today that this is going to be the greatest night of my career so far, and the great thing about it is the best is yet to come.
Can you see improvements in your own performances?
Yeah, huge improvements. I definitely didn't perform to my best there tonight, but the most important thing is I won very clear, and but it's great to win this title, but I'm going to go back to the drawing board and continue to improve. I've got a great team of people behind me, as I said, and I wouldn't be in this position without my coach Ross behind me. He's absolutely incredible, and together we're the dream team.
Let's have a quick word from Eddie. Eddie, the whole of Ireland are going to want to ask you how far and how long to a world title fight.
We're talking to Brian Peters as well, you know, and he's planning the next move over there with us. We're looking probably October, November for that Ireland date. For me, that's the first challenge for a world title. Next will be America in June or July. She must box out there. You've got the American networks here. I can see them sitting over there, and they're all over me to get Katie Taylor on board. You know, she's the most entertaining female fighter on the planet, unquestionably. And what you saw tonight was a lot more professionalism, a lot more mature performance, taking her time. Massive respect for Nina Menke. She would have kept coming all day. And this is a perfect step up for Katie Taylor. First title. America is next in June or July. We're looking at potentially the Ward Kovalev card, or even headlining herself on the East Coast of America. And then we want to bring that world title back to Dublin, October, November 2017.
Get your passport ready. Well done.
Absolutely. Congratulations to Katie Taylor. She